Well, howdy there, folks. This is the Brave Hylian welcoming you back to Let's Play The Legend of Zelda, A Link to the Past. In the last episode, we took out the first palace, and in this episode, we'll be taking on the second palace. So let's get our book out, open it up, and open the way to our dungeon here. When I was a kid, this was always the dungeon that I really didn't like because there seemed to be a lot of rooms in this dungeon that are sort of red herrings. There's no point to going in them, you don't get anything out of them, and it's really annoying. But if you know your way through it, it can be very simple and easy. However, the boss in this dungeon remains a pain in the ass to this day, and I don't think that'll ever change. It's just not a fun way to end this dungeon. And I'm not a huge fan of sandy atmospheres in video games as it is, so, well, I don't know what the hell I'm doing in here because I'm not supposed to be in here right now. I'm supposed to go up here instead of left. That was stupid. And yeah, the enemies in this dungeon do step up a little bit in difficulty. Most of them can hurt you a little bit more than what you've seen before, so that can be a little obnoxious. I never fully realized the actual pinkness of Link's hair before playing this on my large computer monitor. I don't know, when I was playing it on a TV before, it never seemed quite so vibrant and pink. Because when I don't know, I noticed that he had pink hair before, but it's always been like, oh, well, I mean, it's not that pink, it's just, you know, it's a little tinged. But no, it really is, like, fully vibrant, colorful, flamboyant pink. And none, you know, there's nothing wrong with that, it's just weird. It's just inconsistent with most of the other Zelda games. So, yeah, I don't know. In a lot of the ROM hacks that I've seen, Link actually has more blonde hair, and it looks much more normal. And I'm not sure what those red pants are all about either. Of course, who am I to question Link's fashion sense? You know, I don't go around dashing with my sword and running into enemies and saving the world and all that, so I don't know if I can really talk. But, you know, I don't know. Maybe back in 1991 or 92 or whatever it was, that was part of the fashion. I can't really speak. I was either not born or not even a year old, so I can't say I remember that too well. But anyway, we just got the Power Glove, and I love the Power Glove. It's so bad. And that will allow us to lift up some things that we couldn't lift up before, so that'll be really useful. And we will go outside here, dash down, run into a vulture, I believe. Oh, we missed him, but we do pick up a heart piece, and that was the goal, so that's good. And back here we have the much more linear second half of the dungeon, stop me if you've heard this before, where we will eventually end up facing the boss. So these enemies right here are tiles that come out of the ground and fly towards you. There's only one room in the game where they really can't be avoided, and we'll be seeing that room pretty soon, but they are also an enemy that was repeated in future games, and I can't say I'm a big fan of them, to be honest. Even when you can avoid them, they are quite a pain, and they do, if I remember, quite a bit of damage to you if you actually hit them. So, wow, I got insanely lucky in that room with all those Beemos trying to kick my ass. I can't believe that none of them actually hit me, and we are absolutely blazing through this palace. I mean, not that there's really anything to it so that you wouldn't be able to, but man, it's just really easy. Right here you have to light all the torches with your lantern so as to move the wall over so that you can get to the boss room, and that's really all there is to it. Now, as I said, this boss can be a little bit of an annoyance, but I don't know, as long as you find a strategy and stick to it, it's not too bad. There are three little worms that fly out of the ground. They are called Landmolas, and they do a whole heart of damage to you if you hit them, and I can't believe I just got hit twice. That was dumb. Wow, three times. This is really bad. I know I have a fairy, but I'd still like to not waste it on this. Okay, so we're having a little bit of trouble with the Landmolas. What else is new? yeah, not fun. I would try spin attacks on these guys, but they don't. It doesn't seem to do twice the damage on them as it's supposed to, and as it does with other enemies. So that's annoying. Not sure why he only did a half a heart of damage to me there. That was weird. I think it was because I got hit by a rock and not by the actual worm itself. So that makes sense, I suppose. Making direct contact with it probably would hurt more than getting hit by a rock that was spit out when it came out of the ground anyway. It makes sense why they would do it that way. Ow, again. I'm really glad I can't actually hear that beeping right now. That's cool. I don't miss that sound at all, actually. And when you get down to one of these, it will start to shoot the rocks out in eight directions, which can really be a pain. And we're about to see that right now, so hopefully we don't die here. Not trying to do that. I'm not sure how much I've actually hit this one in particular. Hopefully it'll be dead soon, but I couldn't say for sure, so yeah. I should have been being, you know, patient and a little bit slower earlier rather than just going after it all at once, kind of like I am now. Yeah, there we go, we got him. We're never in any trouble there, I knew that. So yeah, that's the second pendant, and we got the flashy spin again. That's awesome. So yeah, that is definitely the hardest part of that dungeon. There's really nothing to it. You can really blaze through it if you're keep your head on a swivel, son, you know? Okay, so with that done, I think we're gonna go collect a few things before we head on to our next place that we gotta go. And the first thing that we're going to do is take Sahasrara's advice from last episode and go over to the east side of Lake Hylia and look for an item that will be useful to us there. So, that is right over here, and we will go on and dash over here. And I wanted to mention real quick that up here, behind this bombable wall, is a cave where you can get 360 rupees if you're crafty with your bombs and your arrows. Since I already have 500 and some, I don't really need to go in there, and I'm not going to, and there's nothing else in there, so I'm going to skip it for now, but if you want to go in there and get up some rupees, especially during a speedrun, it's really useful. That is a place where you can do it, so that's nice. And here's where we want to go. There's also rupees in this cave down here, and they respawn when you get out of it, so that's a good place to grind as well. There's also a cave over by the second palace where we just were that you can grind for rupees in. And this is the ice rod, which we will not use until very close to the end of the game, but it is an item that you need, so make sure you pick that up. And now that that's done, I'm tired of being around all this water and not being able to swim, so I think the next thing I'm going to do is run over and go buy me some Zora flippers. And that will also give us a couple of other upgrades that'll be really nice to have. So, yeah. I think between the second and the third palaces in this game is probably the best time to do most of your collection, because right after the third palace you're going to want to pretty much get to the castle and get to the Dark World as fast as possible. So this is really the best time, and the power glove is really the only thing you really need to do most of this stuff, so it's definitely a good time to do it, and we haven't had a really good collection episode yet, so maybe this will be that. Yeah, hopefully we can have a couple more heart pieces by the time we get to the third palace too, although I'm not sure. I know there's two that we can get up on Death Mountain, and I know we already have one. So that should be pretty good. I know there's one down by the cistern that I could have gotten over by the second, near close to the second palace, sort of, but I like to get that one when I'm doing a different sort of, how do I really explain that? When I'm doing a different part of the game, it's much more convenient to grab it at that time, so I just usually wait to get it. And even if I don't have 8 hearts going into the third palace, it's not going to be a huge calamity. The enemies don't really start to ramp up in the dungeons until the Dark World, pardon me. So it's not really that important that we have it yet. This part up here is, I suppose, Zora's domain. And some of the enemies can give you a little bit of trouble in here because they'll shoot their lasers and they pop out of the water, and that guy can be really hard to get by because you have to walk diagonally and you can't go in the deep water, you can only go in the shallows. So it can be a bit of a crapshoot that way, but ow. We'll be able to do something about those lasers shooting at us really soon. Definitely by the end of this video, so. And this is King Zora here, and he will sell us some flippers for 500 rupees, and we happen to have a little bit more than that. So we will gladly pay you Tuesday for a hamburger today, and grab us some Zora flippers. Very useful, and once again, opens up quite a few side quests as a, you know, as a way of getting around. Most notably, we'll be going to grab a bottle right here in a moment. So that's our second piece of heart, and that'll be good. And go down the waterfalls. You can't go up waterfalls with your Zora flippers, so that's not, you know, it doesn't quite go to that level of transportation, but you can go, there's one notable exception to that which I just told you, and it's this waterfall right here. You can walk into it, and there is a toad house. Yes, a mysterious pond into which we will throw an item, and the first item we will throw will be our boomerang. And when you do that, a fairy will pop out, and she'll say, "Hello there, did you drop this?" And I will say, "Yes." And then she will give us back the magical boomerang, and that is definitely a very good item to have, because it goes farther and it cuts down some things that it didn't cut down before. And the other thing that we will throw in is our shield. And that will be how we repel the fireballs that we could not take care of before. So that's definitely a very good upgrade to have as well. Also, I'd like to mention that you can throw an empty bottle into the fairy fountain, and it will return you with it full of green potion, which replenishes all of your magic power. So that's also a good thing to do. Not necessarily at this point in the game, we don't need magic for anything right now, but that is something that you can do, and there's I think a couple other fairy fountains in the game. So on that island up there to my left right now is the way that you get upgrades for your bombs and arrows capacity carrying, getting more of those. So that's something that I don't consider to be necessarily part of the 100% of a game, because you're not really doing anything besides collecting rupees and then throwing them into the fountain, which is not really a side quest in any sense. So I don't really care about that. I'm not going to do it. I don't really, you know, I don't need anything. I don't need an upgrade to my bomber arrow carrying capacity. It's nice to have, but this guy is going to give us a bottle, so that's really nice. And yeah, I didn't know that this guy existed under this bridge for like the longest time when I was a kid. I never knew how to get the fourth bottle, because for me that was always the fourth one, because I always got the other ones first. So yeah, that can definitely be something that you could be easily missed if you didn't know that you could actually go under there, because there's not that many areas like that in the game where you can go, you know, like under a bridge or anything like that. That's not something that you'd normally be able to do. So yes, anyway, we are now going to find that other portal, wherever that is. That's the one where we came in. We don't necessarily want to go way back over there, but I would like to go to where the other one will lead us, which is... Aha, yes. Right over here. If you swim into these whirlpools, the ones that Zoras don't pop out of, they will warp you to different areas in the world. That's something that King Zora kind of mentioned a moment ago when we saw him. So let's get our magical boomerang out and give it a try. One new thing that I can do, I believe, is cut signs in half. No, that must be in the Game Boy version. I know it can, I'm pretty sure it can cut bushes, but I'm not really positive about that. Either way, it goes a lot farther, and that's really what is important about that. This cave right here is how you get onto Death Mountain, which is our next area. And we'll meet this old man here who is lost, or who lost his lamp rather, but he does know the way, so that's good. Because we don't necessarily know the way ourselves, so he's provides a little bit of a backstory about the Triforce. So his daughter is actually one of the seven maidens who was kidnapped by Ganon, so, or a granddaughter rather, excuse me. And he's talking about Aghanim and what he's doing with all the maidens. So We're about to end our episode here when this gentleman gives us the item that he's supposed to give me. And that item is the magic mirror, which is not really useful to us at all right now, but it will end up being one of the most used items in the game by the time it's over. So I will stop in his cave right here, and that'll be all for this episode of Let's Play The Legend of Zelda, A Link to the Past. This has been the Brave Hylian bringing this to you today, and I'll be signing off for now. Thank you all very much for watching, and have a great day. Bye now.